Hi everyone, my name is Steve Lillyston and you're tuned into Our Library, which is a 60-minute program sponsored by the lovely folk at the libraries from around Wairarapa to let you know about some of the many new books being introduced into the libraries. So you can get in quick and maybe place a reservation on them if you're interested. And I'll also be talking about some of the services and programs that are on offer in the libraries around Wairarapa. Our library is being broadcast to you today on Arrow 92.7 FM, your community access radio channel, and Wairarapa TV on Freeview Channel 41. This program is broadcast live on the third Friday of each month at 3:30 and repeated on the fourth Friday again at 3:30. So let's get started. First up, we'll look at some of the new fiction coming into the libraries around Wairarapa in the coming months. And first I've got Basil's War. Basil's War by Stephen Hunter. Basil St. Florian is an accomplished agent in the British Army, tasked with dozens of dangerous missions for Crown and country across the globe. But his current mission, going undercover in Nazi-occupied France during World War II, might be his toughest assignment yet. He will be searching for an ecclesiastic manuscript that doesn't officially exist, one that genius Professor Alan Turing believes may hold the key to a code that could prevent the death of millions and possibly even the end of the war. St. Florian isn't the classic British special agent with a stiff upper lip. He is a swashbuckling, whiskey-drinking cynic and thrill-seeker who resents having to leave Vivian Lee's bed to set out on his crucial mission. Who wouldn't? Despite these proclivities, though, Basil's army superiors know he's the best man for the job, carrying out his espionage with enough charm and quick wit to make any of his subjects lower their guards. So that sounds like a lot of fun. Rollicking fun. That's Stephen Hunter, Basil's War by Stephen Hunter. Stephen Hunter won the 2003 Pulitzer Prize for Criticism, as well as the 1998 American Society of Newspapers Editor Award for Distinguished Writing in Criticism for his work as film critic at the Washington Post. So he's no slouch, I guess that's what we're saying here. He's the author of several best-selling novels, including Time to Hunt, Black Light, Point of Impact, and the New York Times bestsellers Havana, Pale Horse Coming, and Hot Springs. And he lives in Baltimore. So that's Basil's War by Stephen Hunter. Next up, I've got The Clockmaker's Wife. Now, this is by Daisy Wood. London, 1940. Britain is gripped by the terror of the Blitz, forcing Nell Spellman to flee the capital with her young daughter, leaving behind her husband Arthur, the clockmaker, who keeps Big Ben chiming. When Arthur disappears, Nell is desperate to find him, but her search will lead her into far darker places than she ever imagined. New York, present day. When Ellie discovers a beautiful watch that had once belonged to her grandmother she never knew, she becomes determined to find out what happened to her. But as she pieces together the fragments of her grandmother's life, she begins to wonder if the past is better left forgotten. So that's The Clockmaker's Wife by Daisy Wood. Now, Daisy Wood worked in children's publishing for some years before leaving to concentrate on her own writing. She's the author of the Swallowcliffe Hall series for young adults under the name of Jenny Walters. The Clockmaker's Wife is her first published novel for adults. Happiest rootling about the London Library under the pretext of research, she divides her time between London and Dorset and can often be seen chasing a rescue pointer through various city parks with a basset hound in tow. That's The Clockmaker's Wife by Daisy Wood. Interesting sort of book, I thought, and obviously a lot of background in teen fiction, and now she's spreading out into adult fiction. I'm sure that'll be very good. Next, I've got Seven Perfect Things. This is by Catherine Ryan Hyde. 13-year-old Abby Hubble lives in an unhappy home in the Sierra Nevada foothills, where her father makes life miserable for her and her mother, Mary. One day, Abby witnesses a man dump a litter of puppies into the nearby river. Diving in to rescue all seven, she knows she won't be able to bring them home. Afraid for their fate at the pound, she takes them to an abandoned cabin, where all she can offer is a promise that she'll be back the next day. To grieving widower Elliot Colvin, life has lost meaning. Looking for solace, he retreats to the hunting cabin he last visited years ago before his wife's illness. What he discovers is not at all what he expected. Seven puppies and one determined girl with an indomitable heart. As Abby and Elliot's friendship deepens, Abby imagines how much better her life and the puppies' lives would be if her mother were married to Elliot instead of her father. But when Abby's father moves the family hundreds of miles away, Abby and her mother must decide how long they're willing to defer happiness. This is Seven Perfect Things by Catherine Ryan Hyde. Catherine Ryan Hyde, born Buffalo, New York, 1955, novelist and short story writer. She's very popular, very prolific. Her novels tend to be sort of tender and heartwarming family type novels. I love to read her novels. I've read quite a lot of her novels. And it's as a break, if you like, from the more deep and meaningful ones. It's not very serious, it's just really lovely and heartwarming. And in this one, she's also worked dogs into her novel, as she does with, she's done that with a few novels. And I love books all about dogs. So my doggy books, I call them. So that's quite lovely. And it's actually one of the books I got out. I was so intrigued by that. And I love Catherine Ryan Hyde. I got it out last time around. So it's one of the books I read this month. Seven Perfect Things by Catherine Ryan Hyde. Next up is Sin and Spirit. This is by K.F. Breen. Karen, this is a real switcheroony here. Karen has stepped up to take his place as the ruler of magical San Francisco. As his girlfriend, I'm in the spotlight, and the Hades demigods have taken notice. They want me on their team, and they don't plan on asking nicely. Karen and I are both under fire. They will kill him to get to me, and they'll take me by force if necessary. It is essential I learn more of my magic. With no other options, I do what scares me the most. I summon the last spirit walker to help train me. Except he's a loose cannon with looser morals, and learning spirit is treacherous. I might evade the demigods only to be lost in spirit forever. So that's a real escape. Magical San Francisco, without the drugs, I assume. So for lovers of this fantasy, supernatural and paranormal romance genre, you'll be interested to know that there's been 5 new novels of this Sin and series, Sin and Chocolate, Sin and Magic, etc. So this is Sin and Spirit. And those 5 new novels by K.F. Breen in that supernatural paranormal romance genre have been added to the library this month. K.F. Breen is a journalist, Wall Street Journal, Washington Post, etc. And she lives in California. She's a journalist by day and author of novels by night. So if that's your thing, it's not mine, but it might be your thing, that's Sin and Spirit by K.F. Breen. So now, if you've just tuned in, my name is Steve Lillyston, and you're listening to Our Library, which is a 60-minute program sponsored by the lovely folk at the libraries around Wairarapa, to let you know about some of the books coming into the library in the coming months. So I've gone over some fiction. I've now got some more fiction to share with you. Next up is The Sweetness of Water by Nathan Harris. In the dying days of the American Civil War, newly freed brothers Landry and Prentice find themselves cast into the world without a penny to their names. Forced to hide out in the woods near their former Georgia plantation, they're soon discovered by the land's owner, George Walker, a man still reeling from the loss of his son in the war. When the brothers begin to live and work on George's farm, the tentative bonds of trust and union begin to blossom between the strangers. But this sanctuary survives on a knife's edge, and it isn't long before the inhabitants of the nearby town of Old Ox react with fury at the alliances being formed only a few miles away. So that's another switch here back to the American Civil War, which sounds like it could be quite interesting. Nathan Harris, the author of Sweetness of Whatâ, is a Michener follower. No, he's not. He's a Michener fellow at the University of Texas. He was awarded the Kidd Prize as judged by Anthony Doerr and was also a finalist for the Tennessee Williams Fiction Prize. The Sweetness of Whatâ is his debut novel, which has had good write-ups and been very well received. And he lives in Austin, Texas. So that might be a bit of a gamble for you. This is The Sweetness of Whatâ by Nathan Harris, and that's his debut novel. Aftermath by Terry Blackstock. Criminal attorney Jamie Powell will accept the consequences for defending her lifelong friend Dustin when he's accused of setting the bombs that killed dozens at a local political rally. But she hasn't seen him since he aged out of foster care, and he's always lived on the edge. Can she still trust him? As Jamie investigates his case and the people in his life, she realizes the facts coming to light could be devastating. Someone is setting him up. But proving it might destroy Dustin more than the accusation itself. Dustin overcame his childhood, but how can he overcome this? Dustin is now ex-military and owns a security firm, and he's horrified when the police find explosives in the trunk of his car. Is Jamie putting her career on the line by defending an accused terrorist? So that sounded quite interesting from the criminal attorney viewpoint. Terry Blackstock, the author of Aftermath, was born in Illinois in 1957, author of many novels, mainly in the women Christian genre. So I'm not familiar with Terry's work, but that might interest you. That's Aftermath by Terry Blackstock. Now, this is Arctic Storm Rising by Dale Brown. Not Dan Brown, Dale Brown. Don't know whether there's any connection, actually. I should have checked that. After a CIA covert mission goes badly awry, US Air Force intelligence officer Nicholas Flynn is exiled to guard a remote radar post along Alaska's Arctic frontier. This dead-end assignment is designed to put his career permanently on ice. But Flynn's not the type to fade quietly into obscurity. As winter storms pound Alaska and northern Canada, Russian aircraft begin penetrating deep into friendly airspace. Are these rehearsals for a possible first strike? Using Russia's new long-range stealth cruise missiles? Or is it some other motive driving the Kremlin to take ever-increasing risks along the hostile Arctic frontier, separating two of the world's greatest powers? When an American F-22 collides with one of the Russian interlopers, things go south fast. In seconds, missiles are fired. There are no survivors. Despite horrific weather, Flynn and his security team are ordered to parachute into the area in a desperate bid to reach the crash sites ahead of the Russians. It's now obvious that the Pentagon and CIA are withholding vital information, but Flynn and his men have no choice but to make the dangerous jump. Soon they're caught in a deadly game of hide-and-seek with Spetsnaz commandos operating covertly on American soil. It seems that the F-22s and their Russian counterparts aren't the first aircraft to have gone missing in these desolate mountains. The Kremlin is hunting for the first prototype of its new stealth bomber, which vanished on what was supposed to be a test flight, while loaded with nuclear-armed stealth cruise missiles. As Russia and the US square off on the brink of an all-out war, it's up to Nick to find the missing bomber and prevent a potential nuclear holocaust. Ooh. Sounds like a big thriller. If you're into big thrillers, sounds good. Dale Brown, born New York, 1964, is an American writer, surprisingly enough. Ex-military and aviator, known for aviation techno-thriller novels. At least 13 of his novels have been New York Times bestsellers. So if that's your area of interest, aviation techno-thriller novels, this guy would be your man, and he's got the experience to back it up too. So that could be quite a good read. That's Arctic Storm Rising by Dale Brown. Next is The Bombay Prince. This is by Suhata Massey. November 1921, Edward VIII, Prince of Wales and future ruler of India, is arriving in Bombay to begin a four-month tour. The Indian subcontinent is chafing under British rule, and Bombay's solicitor, Parveen Mistry, isn't surprised when local unrest over the royal arrival spirals into riots. But she's horrified by the death of Freeney Cutting Master, an 18-year-old female Parsi student, who falls from a second-floor gallery just as the prince's grand procession is passing by her college. Freeney had come for a legal consultation just days before her death, and what she confided makes Parveen suspicious that her death was not an accident. Parveen, who strongly identified with Freeney, another young Parsi woman fighting hard against the confines of society's rules and expectations, feels terribly guilty for failing to help her. Parveen steps forward to assist Freeney's family in the fraught dealings of the coroner's inquest. And when Freeney's death is ruled a murder, Parveen knows she can't rest until she sees justice done. But Bombay is erupting as armed British Secret Service march the streets, rioters attack anyone with perceived British connections, and desperate shopkeepers destroy their own wares so they will not be targets of racial violence. Can Parveen help a suffering family when her own is in danger? So that's a complete switch. This is India, 1921, Edward VIII, Prince of Wales. Exciting stuff. Sounds really good. Suhata Massey, the author of The Bombay Prince, born 1964 in Sussex. Interesting background this lady's got. Born in Sussex to a father from India and mother from Germany. Emigrated at the age of five with her family to St. Paul, Minnesota, and is a mystery author and historical fiction novelist. Her books are published in published in English, in the US and Canada, United Kingdom, and India, and Australia and New Zealand. Her debut novel, The Salaryman's Wife, won the Agatha Christie Award for Best First Novel in 1997. So quite interesting, her background and her knowledge, certainly of India and that period, makes it sound like a pretty good read. So that's The Bombay Prince by Suhata Massey. Okay then, so at this point I think I'll take a small music break, and when we come back I'll continue to let you know about some of the non-fiction being introduced into Wairarapa libraries in the coming months. So this is Alison Moyet with Falling. This is from her album Essex, hopefully.
Please take me, then I want to drown.
Welcome back. Or if you've just tuned in, my name is Steve Lillyston and you're listening to Our Library, which is a 60-minute program sponsored by the lovely folk from the libraries around Wairarapa to let you know about some of the books coming into the library, in the coming months. And I'll also be talking about some of the services and programs on offer at the libraries around Wairarapa later on. Now, just before the music break, I covered some of the new fiction being introduced into the library, and now I'd like to go over some of the non-fiction. And please remember, all I'm doing is a smattering of the books that are going into the library. There are hundreds, possibly thousands, but at least hundreds, something like 500, 600 into the South Wairarapa, the Wairarapa Library Service. That's the Greytown, Featherston, Carterton, Martinborough, and in the Marston Library. There's got to be double that, I would think. So we're looking about 1,500, maybe 2,000 books coming into the library each month. So it's quite phenomenal. And so I couldn't possibly go over all those, but I'm giving picking a few at random that I thought sound interesting and might interest you. First up in the non-fiction genre is The Smokehouse Handbook. Comprehensive techniques and specialty recipes for smoking meat, fish, and vegetables by Jake Levin or Levin. The process of selecting the right combination of meat, temperature, and wood to achieve the ultimate flavor and texture. Detailed step-by-step photos show the various techniques, including cold smoking, hot smoking, and pit roasting. Levin includes plans and diagrams for building a multi-purpose smokehouse. So, Jake Levin is the author of Smokehouse Handbook, a butcher and charcuterie expert who trained at Fleischer's Meat in Kingston, New York. He has worked in whole animal butcher shops, including the meat market in Great Barrington, Massachusetts, and Eli's Manhattan in New York City, so he knows his stuff. He currently produces cured meats at Charcuterie, an artisanal charcuterie in Ann Cramdale, New York, and travels nationwide conducting workshops on how to slaughter, butcher, and cure meats. He and his wife live in New Marlborough, Massachusetts. So that's obviously for the keen barbecue, and that's anybody's interested in smoking meats and so on. This is the book for you, if you're handy in that way. So that's Smokehouse Handbook by Jake Levin. Next up is Tikanga, Living with the Traditions of Te Ao Māori by Frances Tippany. Following on from their bestseller, Life as a Casketeer, Frances and Kiora Tepani share how they bring the traditional values of Tikanga Māori into day-to-day living and what they know about whānau, mahi, manaakitanga, and how they live a life rich with the concepts of Te Ao Māori. Known for their warm hearts, grace and humour, the stars of the wildly popular series, The Casketeers, show how the traditions of Tikanga shapes their lives, juggling five sons, three businesses and a television show, all while sustaining a life filled with joy and connection. So Frances Tippany is the Managing Director, Chief Operations Officer and Senior Funeral Director at Tippany Funerals. He hails from Pawaringa, Northland, excuse my pronunciation, please, and discovered his calling more than 13 years ago with his first job at an Auckland funeral home. So I'm sure you've seen him on TV or you know about him. That's Tikanga, Living with the Traditions of Te Ao Māori by Frances Tippany. Next is Big Dog, Small Dog. This is by Selena McIntyre. Learning how to communicate with your dog will lead you and your canine companion to a lifetime of happiness. Dog behaviour expert Selena McIntyre uses a natural and direct method, helping humans understand how dogs deal with things like fear, change and anxiety. Big Dog Small Dog is packed with practical advice and natural ways to understand your dog's world. What they really want from their daily walk, what they think about children, and the truth about dog barks. Owning a dog is a huge responsibility, and the more we prepare for such a major life decision, the more we empower ourselves. With the right signals, you'll soon be able to understand and speak your dog's language, helping you cement the foundations of a lasting and positive relationship. For dog owners, I would imagine that would be a really interesting book to read, and a really useful one too. Very informational. Selena McIntyre runs a dog behavioural consultancy called Dog's Best Friend in Waikato. Her study of animal behaviour began as a teenager working with lion cubs at a wildlife park. She has a Bachelor of Applied Animal Technology and strives to bring long-term happiness to every dog she encounters. She lives with her family, her two border terriers, Trev and Lily, and a mostly tolerant black and white moggy, Isabel. So, Big Dog, Small Dog, that's by Selena McIntyre for all you dog owners out there. Really useful book to have read, I would think. And lastly, in the non-fiction genre, we have Jacinda Ardern, Leading with Empathy by Supriya Vanni. Now, Jacinda Ardern was swept into office in 2017, I'm sure you'll remember, with a wave of popular adulation dubbed Jacinda Mania. Her victory seemed heroic. In less than 3 months, she rose from deputy leader of the opposition to the highest office in her nation. Few in politics would have believed it possible. I certainly didn't. Fewer still would have guessed at her resolve and compassionate leadership, which, in the wake of the horrific Christchurch mosque shootings of March 2019 and the struggles of the COVID-19 pandemic, brought her international acclaim and a second term. Acclaimed peace activist and journalist Supriya Vanni builds her narrative through personal interviews with Ardern, and we visit the places, meet the people, and understand the events that propelled the daughter of a small-town Mormon policeman into a committed social democrat, a passionate Labour Party politician, and a model modern leader. Now, whatever you might think of Jacinda Ardern, you have to admit that her rise to the position she's at now has just been incredible. And this is the background, this is a book on the background of that by somebody who knows her stuff. Supriya Vanni is a noted peace activist and human rights campaigner. She's interviewed and discussed issues of human rights and world peace with numerous Nobel Peace Prize laureates, international celebrities, and world leaders. She regularly speaks at universities and government embassies and attends international gatherings and forums such as the World Summit of Nobel Peace Prize laureates and laureates and leaders. She's a board member of the Hague Justice Portal and Caravan for Peace. Supriya's debut book, Battling Injustice, won her acclaim and endorsements from a number of prominent international figures, including Malala Yousafzai, Mikhail Gorbachev, and His Holiness the 14th Dalai Lama. Sounds fascinating. I think that'd be a really neat book to read. So that's Jacinda Ardern, Leading with Empathy by Supriya Vanni. So that's the end of this first segment of our library, during which I gave you a brief smattering of some of the fiction and non-fiction being introduced into the libraries in Wairarapa in the coming months. We'll have another brief music interlude now, and when we come back, I'll talk about some of the books that I've been reading, which you may find interesting, hopefully, and some of the programs and services that are available at the various libraries around Wairarapa. So this is Enya singing Caribbean Blue from her Shepherd Moons album. Hi there, if you've just tuned in, my name is Steve Lillyston and you're listening to Our Library, which is a 60-minute program being sponsored by the lovely folk at the libraries around Wairarapa to let you know about some of the new books being introduced into the library in the coming months and also to talk about some of the services and programs that each of the libraries in Wairarapa have for you. In the first segment of the program, I covered some of the new fiction that's on offer and some of the non-fiction that's being introduced into the library in the coming months. And for this next section, I'd like to start off just to talk about some of the books that I've been reading, which you might find interesting. And then I'll talk about some of the programs that are on offer on the in the libraries around Wairarapa, which I think you'll find very interesting if you don't already know about some of the programs. So first up, I'll talk about the some of the books I've been reading. So in the last month, I've read or tried to read, I'm not always successful, the following 8 books. I managed to try and get 8 books read this month. And the first up is The Tally Stick. This is by Carl Nixon. And I loved it. I thought it was a great book. Carl Nixon is a Kiwi author. The story is set in New Zealand. It's to do with an immigrant family from the UK that come to New Zealand to settle and work and raise the family. But the car goes off the road in the South Island. They're travelling around the South Island. It goes off the road and they're never seen again. So this story is about, it's fiction, of course, but this story is about what happened. And it's a fascinating read. It's a lovely read. I really enjoyed it. And as a result of that, I'm starting to read more of Carl Nixon. He's also a playwright. He's doing the Raft at the moment in The Hut, I think it is, in Hut Repertory by Carl Nixon. Anyway, so that's The Tally Stick by Carl Nixon. Then I tried Burnt Sugar. This is by Avni Doshi. It's set in India, and it's about relationships between mothers and daughters. I didn't get through it, I must admit. I got partway through it. It's interesting to start with, but I sort of lost interest as it moved on. But it's very, very controversial in the Indian community, apparently. As I say, sort of interesting, but in the end, it really didn't do it for me. But the whole concept of mothers and daughters in India is a very interesting concept, especially mothers-in-law, and it covers all that. Fascinating, really. But anyway, so that was me. That was Burnt Sugar by Avni Doshi. Next, I read Where the Crawdads Sing. This is by Delia Owens. And again, I just absolutely love this book. This is set in North Carolina, and it's about a marsh girl. They call her the Marsh Girl, that lives in the swamp. She was part of a family. She's just a young girl, like 7 or 8, I think, 7. And she's abandoned by her family. They all wander off. Mother leaves first, then the children one by one leave, and she's living there with her father. And eventually, I can't remember what happens to him. I think he takes off as well. So all of a sudden, she's there on her own. She doesn't know anybody. She's never been to school. And it's just a lovely story about her and how she manages to live. But she ends up by becoming an expert on the local flora and fauna, writes books. And it's just a magical little book. And as I say, set in Northern Carolina, North Carolina, in the swamps of North Carolina. Lovely book. Where the Crawdads Sing by Delia Owens. Then I tried Enduring Love by Ian McEwan. And nope. I've tried Ian McEwan before, and although he's supposed to be a wonderful writer and many accolades, I'm sorry, I just couldn't read his writing at all. We're all different, and it's just me. That's my attitude towards Ian McEwan. I won't bother to try his work again. I just couldn't get into it. I think I got about 3 paragraphs read, and that was about it. Ditto for Shakespeare on Life and Language by Robert McCrum. I just couldn't get into it. I love Shakespeare. I love books on Shakespeare and Shakespeare's plays. So, yeah, I'm a fan of Shakespeare, but I just was not a fan of this guy's writing. I thought he was just full of himself. I just couldn't follow what he was going on about, and I think I managed about 5 pages of his, So, you know, you win some, you lose some. Mayflies by Andrew O'Hagan, Irish writer. I thought, and I love Irish writers, but again, it started well, but I just lost interest. It didn't really, just didn't hold my interest. I couldn't even tell you what it was about now. So, but that was Mayflies by Andrew O'Hagan. Next up was the Lola Quartet. This is by Emily St. John Mandel. She's a Canadian writer. I've read all of her works, apart from this one, and I really enjoy her writing. She's a lovely, lovely writer. And it's about four people in a jazz group that, at school, at high school, and what happens to them in later life, and the coming together, and how they react to each other, and how they treat each other. The different paths that their lives took. It's just a really interesting book about relationships, about people. Yeah, I really enjoyed that book. That was the Lola Quartet. And then the last one I've just finished reading yesterday, actually. This is Seven Perfect Things. I was talking about that earlier by Catherine Ryan Hyde. Again, I loved it. I love her work. She's really neat. Catherine Ryan Hyde. And I'm currently reading The Nickel Boys for a complete switcheroonie. This is by Colin Whitehead, and it's all about the civil rights in Florida in the 60s. So I'll let you know about that next month. I've only just started it. I've read about three pages, but it sounds interesting. It looks interesting. I'll let you know about that next month. So that's me and what I've been reading. Now, each of the libraries in Wairarapa have a presence on Facebook. You can go onto Facebook and check out all the programs that are on offer, the services that are on offer. Each of them publish their offerings to the public. And don't forget, this is your library. These libraries are free. They don't cost anything to join. And most of the programs that are on offer are free. Or koha, I mean, it's tea and coffee and getting together. I mean, all sorts of really amazing programs. So from the Masters in Library, they have the Check It Out brochure. And so for July, there's a number of programs. And it ranges from all ages, so right from babies. There's a baby bounce where you can go along, listen to stories and songs in English and some in Te Reo here at the library every Tuesday during school term, and that's for the under twos. So that's getting them used to going into libraries, and you get to meet other mums there, and dads, I presume, take your babies along. Story Go Round, that's exploring the world of books and enjoy the magic of stories for preschool. So it's a little bit older, but that sort of age. They have Feel Free to Bring a Morning Snack, Tea and Coffee Provided, every Wednesday during school term, preschool. There's also a Te Reo program, delivered in Te Reo, but it's open to all. Introduce your child to Te Reo with stories, music and crafts. And that's every Thursday during school term. There's even a Lego play. You can go along and play Lego, which I found fascinating. Talking to the folks at the library, I asked about Lego. Why Lego? Of all the things, libraries, Lego? Well, it's to do with dexterity, manual dexterity, and being able to... And it's just all the same, and it's encouraging them to use their hands and manipulate things and working together, teamwork, and it all comes into it. It all works together. The reading, the learning, the literacy, and it's numerical literacy. It's financial literacy, technical literacy, and what's books? Book literacy. And it all works in together. That's what the libraries offer now, not just books. There's a adult programs, a number of adult programs. Set Net and Yarn. That's all getting together and sitting there with people that are interested in crafts, arts and crafts, people with similar interests, if you're interested in arts and crafts, and you can mingle with people with similar interests. It's just a fun thing to do. There's a Scrabble Club. You can join the Marston Scrabble Club or just go along and join in and play a game. You don't have to join, I don't think. Wairarapa Women's Cross Stitch. Again, it's a get-together every Thursday to talk and discuss and work with cross stitch. Or there's a thing called The Gathering, where you just go along and it's like a meeting place. You go to the library, you meet there, tea and coffee, and it's just fun. There's all sorts of things for you to do there. Just meet people if you're a bit lonely. There's a gathering, meet people and just have a chat. And the digital programs, they offer a number of digital programs, digital advice, and you've got very clever people there that can offer you all sorts of advice on your laptops, on your phones, on whatever problems you've got, whatever issues you've got. You can go along there and work it out, get some info, get some advice. They'll even help you to produce a CV. If you want help developing a CV, they'll help you do that. I mean, the programs and on offer there are just incredible. That's the Marston Library. And also, the July school holiday program, we have My Matariki coming up. And there's all sorts of events for that too. There's the Manu Taratahi craft at 10:30 on Monday. There's book sharing on Tuesday. Matariki story time on Wednesday. Lego play on Thursday. There's a number of events all to do with My Matariki. Get along there, talk to the library, pick up a brochure on My Matariki. It'll be a lot of fun. There'll be a lot of people going there. You'll find it very interesting, and the kids will just love it. So that's the Marston Library, but we now have some info for you from the Wairarapa Library Service, which is Carterton, Greytown, Martinborough and Featherston. And they also have a number of programs for the community, for anybody that's a member of the library. And again, it's free to join the library, so a number of these programs are free. Well, they're all free, apart from maybe the odd koha. But I thought this was really interesting. From the Wairarapa Library Service, they're holding a creative writing class for kids. Our favourite stories feel like magic. In truth, there's a wonderful craft behind that magic, with a writer choosing every little detail. This July holidays, the Wairarapa Library Service will offer young readers year six and up a chance to discover the joy of writing their own stories with classes at each of our four branches. That's the four towns, obviously, you know about. How to write a story began this week, looking at how to create a world in which a story takes place. And we'll continue next week with a focus on writing the hero of your story. Classes will meet at each of the libraries, Carterton on Monday between 2 and 3, Greytown on Tuesdays between 10 and 11, Featherston on Thursdays between 2 and 3, and Martinborough on Friday between 10 and 11. Now, I don't expect you to remember all that, but if you contact your library and you've got a child who's interested in writing, they can actually get free classes on how to write stories. I thought that was really neat. Bring local history to life through audio storytelling. If you're interested in audio storytelling, Wairarapa Library Services Greytown Library is promoting audio storytelling as a valuable tool to record and celebrate a rich local history. And that's on, in fact, I think that might, it's August 19th. What's today? Come and hear Wellington Oral historians Dr. Emma Jean Kelly and Pip Oldham speak about their experiences creating podcasts from oral histories. I mean, just really, really useful thing to go. If that's your thing. Kelly led an oral history project on the 2020 lockdown that became Radio New Zealand's podcast, Kairoto Iti Miru, Inside the Bubble, while Oldham has worked with the Marsden Fund's Family Memory Project, recording intergenerational family memory among the descendants of New Zealand's early settlers. So there's so much going on. This is the so that's bringing local history to life through audio storytelling. If that's your thing, you can give them a call and find out where the next session is for that. Wairarapa Libraries to interview Selina Tusitala Marsh hosts virtual story time. So join the Wairarapa Library Service online Wednesday, 28th of July, for two great local events in the nationwide Books Alive series, celebrating books nominated for the New Zealand Book Awards for children and young adults. At 12:30 p.m. that day, award-winning poet Selina Tusitala Marsh will join Bringing Reading to Life champion Dan Keane for an interview about her Mophead 2, the Queen's poem, a lively illustrated account of Marsh's trip to London to recite a poem for the Queen. The book has been nominated for an Elsie Locke Non-Fiction Award. So to join the online event, register at the following link. Now, there's a big link there, which I'm not going to read to you. But if you're interested in that online session, contact any one of the libraries in South Wairarapa from Greytown or Featherston, Martinborough, Carterton, and ask them about the virtual story time, when and where that's on. The same day, Penelope Griffin, Featherston branch librarian, will continue her popular online readings with the Midnight Adventures of Ruru and Kiwi. And Claire Scott and Amy Harhoff joining the Books Alive virtual storytime series. The beautiful picture book and New Zealand retelling of the classic tale of the Owl and the Pussycat is nominated for a Best First Book Award. Look for the video on the WLS Libraries Facebook pages. Again, check out the Facebook pages. There's lots of information on there and talks about all the programs that are coming up. All this is mentioned on there, so make sure you check out the Facebook pages for your local library and get some good info there. And if you're not a member, join up, please. It's free. There's just so much going on there for you, for your children, for your mother, for your grandmother. There's everything for everybody. It's just a great facility. This is your facility. This is a community facility. And you should take advantage of it. I know I do. So I think that's about all I've got time for this month. Thank you for listening. This was Our Library, a 60-minute programme sponsored by the lovely folk at the libraries all around Wairarapa, to let you know about some of the many new books being introduced into the library in the coming months, and also talking about some of the services and programmes that are on offer at the various libraries around Wairarapa. Thank you for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed the show. Please tune in again next time to Our Library, which will be on Friday, August 20th at 3:30 p.m. on Arrow 92.7, your community access radio channel, and Wairarapa TV on Freeview Channel 41. Until then, happy reading. Bye-bye.